All right, well, we can get started anytime.
Yes.
Yeah, thanks for waiting.
Cool. Five.
Four.
Three.
Two.
And one.
One.
Hello, world, hear the song that we're singing. Come on, get happy.
Ladies and gentlemen, mesdames, messieurs, bienvenue, welcome to the Happy Hour.
Welcome back, Happy Hour listeners. It's that time of the week again where we, Dave, Beth, Veronica, talk about our loved, beloved Montreal Canadiens. My name is David Auger at Glaucus123. I'll actually explain the meaning of it in this episode. Since it's been going on perhaps 2-3 weeks now, since people have been wondering. Yeah, I know, the mailbag is bursting at the seams with questions as to why that's my new username. I'm joined as always by Beth.
Hello.
Video game thing.
I'm at HIVERHYT on Twitter.
And Veronica.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm at CHILE underscore pepper. Just period the end.
We are the Habby Hour at Habby Hour on Twitter, Habby Hour Pod on Instagram, youtube.com/Habby Hour, and HabbyHour.com. Since we last recorded, the Habs faced the Ottawa Senators, and they lost again because it was a reverse retro night, as is,
tradition.
You know, that's just it. If they're going, if it's a reverse retro night, they're going to lose. It does not matter. Despite the fact Rafael Javi Pinard made quite an effort to not have that happen.
Yeah, he really tried hard.
Until the Habs packed their own shit in and let Brady Tkachuk score the fucking equalizing, breaking freaking goal that made it 5-4 at like the a minute and a half mark of the fucking game.
He was running away from fucking the sheriff.
Yeah. Big, tough Brady Tkachuk doesn't want to fight Arbor Jacki, the apparent, arch enemy of the Ottawa Senators ever since I saw Arbor murder like two people during the rookie tournament back in October.
Yeah. Yes.
Absolutely obliterated people. And back then, God, I will quote someone of prominent Hab. Social, what's the word for it?
Prominence
is close.
Prominence.
This person said, "I don't think Arbor Jacki has the NHL toolbox." No. Well,
that did not age well.
No, because he has the Costco one.
That's right.
Costco.
A BOGO, if you will.
Executive membership, yo.
Points and everything. I don't know
that's
how
what
Costco
I got.
Works.
I got the black card. Ooh. Oh, yeah, they send me a check every year.
Oh, that's nice.
Money back.
It's kind of like those guys that, those folks that live in Alaska, they get an extra stipend because of the oil industry over there.
Yeah.
Very nice.
And also have to live in Alaska.
Yes. True story.
Although it's one of my bucket list places. It's so gorgeous. I would love to go there, but there ain't nothing there except murderers.
Yeah, nothing but murderers and moose.
Yep.
Crazy murderers.
Yeah, oh, crazy murderers. Not even like sane murderers at that.
I saw a Dateline a couple of months ago where the killer was a policeman.
Well, I mean, yeah. It's America and the police.
From the club and killed her and murdered her dead.
Have you heard about the one where
have
the
you
guy
seen
like,
white people
was he was murdering the prostitutes? He was murdering the sex workers in Alaska, and like he was like taking them in his plane and flying them to a remote cabin, and the one girl like got out of the car when they got to the airfield and just started running and just ran in the middle of the road and waited for somebody to stop for her.
Naked in Alaska.
Yeah.
And when they finally did track him down, because you know how the story goes, if it's a sex worker, it's given less priority because
exactly
for some reason they're not humans.
Bad people.
There's a term that they call it actually in police lingo. What is it, Beth? I've heard it on My Favorite Murder. I don't know how many times. But it's kind of like an acronym for basically non-human victim.
Oh, I don't know
like
what
that.
It's called.
So when they finally caught this guy, he had just like an arsenal of shit in his attic in the insulation. Yeah. Unless I'm getting my killers mixed up.
But I mean, yeah, there are a lot of them.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. Anyway, we don't want to go to Alaska. No. We don't want to live there.
We don't want to live there, Alaska.
So aside from the Costco bucks and the oil cash that some people get, I will conclude that branch of this week's podcast by saying I used to have a roommate who would collect on those oil checks, even though he was not currently living in Alaska. So I hope he or she is doing very well and avoiding the authorities. Fuck the man. Fuck the man.
Was this wasn't a Keegan, was it?
Nope. That's not this person's name. That is not this person's name. I've never heard that name in my life.
I didn't know if we're going to out him because we didn't like him.
We support him. Them.
No. I meant the other person.
I cannot confirm nor deny at any point in my life that there was a roommate that may or may not have been from Alaska, whom previously before possibly becoming my roommate lived on a boat.
Oh, that roommate. I know who you're talking about now, Beth.
This particular maybe person also had a stunning girlfriend, supposedly.
Uh-huh.
Supposedly.
Yes.
So one game for the Habs in the past week, parce que the All-Star weekend, then leading into the Habs bye week. This is literally the bye week now, meaning that...
Are they playing tomorrow?
No. They'll play until Saturday.
No, they don't play until like...
Oh, wow. Oh, okay.
Yeah. They do not play until Saturday,
ooh,
February 11. A game which I will not watch because I will be in New York City.
New York City?
New York City.
Going to get some...
NYC.
What was that for? Chili or something? Actually, I'm going to be staying in Brooklyn, your favorite place in the world.
Oh, I really want to go to Brooklyn.
I know. That's what I said that. I am taking the Amtrak down. Rare for me to not drive. But I realized, wait, if I'm going into Brooklyn, I'm going to be paying like...
Where are you
going
to park?
Well, there's that. You know, parking, number one, if. Number two... I didn't realize how severe the tolls were getting into New York City. Because you cross the George Washington Bridge, you're literally paying $18.
Yeah, it's a lot of money.
Yeah. And then that's not the only bridge you have to go through. You know, you have that to get into Manhattan. Then you have the Battery, the underwater one, to go into Brooklyn. Or you can go in by Queens using the JFK. But that's like another $10 either or that you do.
Oh my God, that sounds like my dream road trip.
So that's like, well, I mean, yeah, you can do it once and pay the money. Like, I did it. Get the shirt. Paid tolls in New York City.
I'll bring friends. We'll split it.
So, parking, that's a question mark. $20, $40 probably all together for 2 days. Tolls there and back, I already mentioned, okay. $20, $30, $40 one way perhaps. Well, maybe both ways. So that's $80 without even including gas. Amtrak exists.
Yes, it does.
And it has a station in Albany, $90 there and back.
Hell yeah.
So and you can read and fucking play your video game, not have to worry about traffic.
Exactly. So that's what I'm going to do. And that is why I will not be watching the Habs that particular day. Oh, they're both afternoon games, too, at least for us on the East Coast.
Oh, is that Super Bowl weekend?
Oh, it is Super Bowl weekend.
I was wondering about that the other day. Isn't it kind of late this year?
My mother yesterday was at the Pro Bowl. On the field at the Pro Bowl, kind of surprising.
Is your mom secretly on the field?
At some point in the family group chat, she says, "Hey, family, we're on the field at the Pro Bowl. A lot of fun." It's like, what? What do you mean you're on the field?
Is TikTok famous? Because a lot of like the TikTok famous people were at the Pro Bowl on the field yesterday.
It's like, how the fuck did she manage? Anyway, so Habs fall to the Senators. I believe they have a losing streak now, the Habs, as one does.
Yeah.
Yep. That previous Saturday, 5-0, Habs got demolished by the Ottawa Senators. 5-4 afterwards, Detroit topped them in overtime, Boston, of course. The last time the Habs won, the last team to give the Habs a victory were the Toronto Maple Leafs. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Very nice. Very
Thanks.
Nice. Thanks,
I wonder
guys.
If Austin Matthews got injured.
Oh, did he? When? That's Probably too not. Bad. Oh.
He got injured, so he couldn't go to the All-Star game.
Oh.
Oh, no.
Yeah, it was, I think, the Ottawa game that the Leafs lost, and then to Montreal. The first game, though, I think that he was gone was the Ottawa game.
That's so sad.
So sad.
I'm absolutely mortified and just beside myself with grief.
He's fine, though, right? He's
fine.
Yeah, it's like an ankle injury. He'll be fine.
He's fine.
I did Red Rum. Red Rum. I meant to go like this, but instead I did Red Rum.
I don't want to go there, Mrs. Torrance.
What's so wild about that is there's a new movie out on Netflix. Since there's so much Habs news to talk about, but there's a new movie on Netflix called You People. I'm pretty sure Eddie Murphy is in it with Jonah Hill.
And Julia Louis-Dreyfus.
Yes. And so here's the catch on this one. I was pre-gaming with some people, and a couple was watching the movie, and I was sitting there, and they had there was a scene with Jonah Hill, Julianne Dreyfus, and they were having like a family thing. Julianne Dreyfus, right?
Julia Louis-Dreyfus.
Julia Louis-Dreyfus. Thank you.
Yeah.
Formerly of Seinfeld.
SNL originally.
And SNL originally.
She was like 12 years old. Holy wow. Shit. They were doing pictures the other day. She was such a baby.
That's funny. So,
yeah.
So, Julia Louis-Dreyfus, her husband is played by David Duchovny.
Oh, no.
And
I've had it.
So, I'm sitting there and I'm like, hey, that's David Duchovny. And nobody had any idea what I was talking about. And I was like, X-Files? No. X-Files?
What about Why Don't You Love Me, David Duchovny? That song? I think it was, who sang that song? It was one of the like sort of punky girl bands from the 90s. David Duchovny, Why Don't You Love Me? Something like that.
I've never heard that song before.
Yeah. Frequent guest of the Number 5 Orange establishment in Vancouver when they were filming X-Files here. Number 5 Orange is renowned worldwide.
That's awesome. I would love to meet David Duchovny because his character in You People is extraordinary.
He's very good, isn't he?
White suburban dad that just has no concept of racism. He's like, I really like your braids. How often do you do them?
Oh, good heavens.
It's incredible. It's
wholesome. It's kind of wholesome, please tell me.
It's that really strange, wholesome racism. It's like, damn it. How do you?
It's just ignorance.
Really. It is. It's like, have you ever met Exhibit? Love is music.
That's what I try to say a lot of the time. It's like, there isn't always mean spiritedness. It's just
he plays it so well. I was like, wow. It almost reminds me of my grandpa, because my grandpa was like almost the same exact way whenever he had to interact with anybody that was darker than mayonnaise, you know. So
can I interject with a brief story, relatable for me? As a young child, I was in kindergarten in Montreal, actually. Ooh. Senior high school.
Nice.
I was outside and I went by those swings and they're still there. Oh man, it was crazy. So senior high school, outdoors, recess, I ran behind some swings to catch a ball and a swing hit me because I was obviously in the terrible place and hit me in the head and got me in the side of the head and like blood started gushing all over the place. Long story short, so I ended up getting stitches on this side. My mom didn't drive. She had to come to the, I think I've told this story before. She had to come to the school on her bike. And I was in kindergarten and I went on the, in the kiddie seat on the back and she drove me to the hospital to get my stitches.
Just bleeding. Just bleeding out in the back of the bicycle.
Oh my God. I got hit and I was just kind of stunned and I just kind of started making my way to the school and the sea of kids just parted and the teachers were all like, so anyway, that was one day. The next.
Veronica, what are you doing? Yes, get your fave, Veronica. What the fuck?
Teachers picked me up and carried me into the school, and I was just like, "Wow, I'm the star of my own movie right now." And so then,
yeah.
like 3 years later, we were living in Ottawa. My parents left us alone, of course, because that's the way it was in those days on a summer day. Mm-hmm. I went running into the basement to turn on the faucet for the hose outside because we were having water fights, fell down the stairs, hit my other side of my head. So I have two scars. I have one here and I have one here, and they're basically identical. Flash forward, we're living in Saskatoon. I'm maybe 14, 15. And our neighbor asked my mom if that's what they do to all the girls in Chile. And my mom was like,
oh my God.
And I was just like, I didn't even think anything about it because I like, but she was just like, what do they think we are? Like, what do they, just because I've got identical scars. And is that a thing that they do in Chile? When they pierce our ears, they slice our temples.
I mean, when you got to get that winged eyeliner just right, oh my God. You might as well have like an aid.
When I don't wear my glasses, because it makes my eyebrows kind of look like they're very long. Wow. Anyway, I'll show you up close one time. I got identical scars.
That's awesome.
Stories to tell.
So Habs lost 5-4. Claude Giroux, Tim Stützle opened the scoring. Kirby Dach, power play goal. Amazing. The actual power play has been decent. Granted, this is the Ottawa Senators. So, I mean, can't really read too much into it. Then it was Alex DeBrincat. another power play goal in the second period. Makes it 3-1 Ottawa. Then Michael Hoffman finally unleashes that slap shot that we've been waiting for on the right circle. The right circle where we always wanted Alex Galchenyuk to be with his one-timer. Because in his time with the Habs, when Galchenyuk was on the ball in the power play, that was a wicked spot for him.
Yeah.
Mike Hoffman, you know, makes it a 3-2, trailing Ottawa still. Then it was Raphael Javi Pignard, probably playing some of the best hockey in his life. Ties it up, followed by Tim Stützle again on the power play. Then Raphael Javi Pignard says, no, I will score again. Once more.
Doing all the work.
Another two-goal game in like the span of a week, maybe? Maybe less? Yeah. We were on hat-trick watch again. And then fucking Brady Tkachuk. And there it was.
Oh, somebody tallied up his points in number of games and said that Raphael Harvey-Pignard is better than the kid over there on the Leafs. Thompson.
Something like that. Robinson?
Maybe. I don't know. It was kind of funny because he had way more points in many fewer games.
Yeah.
Robertson. Is it Robertson?
Robertson. The people that they, the Leafs version of Caulfield, which is not even close.
Not even Caulfield light.
Yeah. Yeah. Sorry. Honestly, come on now. Please stop embarrassing the rest of the league with your antics, Leafs Nation. My God. God, it's like that kid that like obviously did not read the book report, giving the book report when it's due. And it's like, that's the Toronto Maple Leafs. It's like, I feel bad for you, Chad. What the hell are you doing? Read the book. It's the spark notes even. Just fake it. No, zero preparation. It's embarrassing to watch. And that's it. That was the only game. And then the All-Star festivities. And I did not watch a second of the All-Star game, the competition. None of it. Because I just don't care. Marner assisted on a Suzuki goal. Apparently, the Atlantic All-Stars won, which never happens.
Oh, yay!
Yeah. So, good job.
They did.
Yeah. Hope everybody had fun. I hope the children enjoyed it.
Yeah.
I used to watch it when I was little. Yeah. I thought it was a lot of fun.
It used to be a lot more fun, and now it's.
It used to be, or maybe I'm too old now.
No, they changed it so much.
Yeah.
Apparently, the AHL All Star competition was way better than the NHL one.
There's
again,
a Ferris wheel there outside of Postville.
I mean, of course. What else are you going to do on a cold winter's night but go on a Ferris wheel in Laval?
Exactly.
Not to say. It would be nice, but it was damned cold these past few days, especially last weekend. Oh, yeah. No, just a few days ago. Yeah, it was the Fimbul winter, the harbinger of Ragnarok in Norse mythology. It was very bad. It was very cold. And then that's it. That's all the Habs news I have. Cole had his surgery. His arm's in a sling now. A friend of mine texted me saying, what the fuck happened and why does he look like he's nine when he's in the hospital bed? Like,
and he's wearing his whatever
kid hat that all the kids have.
He went out to dinner
with his family. Like, he's doing fine. He's in Wisconsin.
Yeah, when you when you have surgery at 9, you have to go fishing at 9:30 for your bucket hat. So there it is.
The bean pot starts today in
the bean pot.
It's a like a tournament between all of the Boston hockey college hockey teams.
Oh, cool.
I fucking hate Boston.
Lane Hutson plays for Boston University. And he's been doing really well. Like, he keeps getting nominated for like Rookie of the Week, Rookie of the Month, blah blah blah. So everybody's like really pulling for him to get the Hobie Baker.
As a freshman. A bit unheard of.
Yes.
Yeah, wow.
For those of you who need a refresher, Lane Hutson was drafted 62nd overall by the Habs this past summer. He is the kid who brought his doctor's note that says, I'm going to fucking grow.
I am tall.
So in this first round, so there's only one period left for it. It's just... Like basically it's four colleges, two teams play each other, The winners of each of those games go on to the final, and then the other two teams play like the consolation round to figure out who gets third place, basically.
That's not a round robin, so I do not care.
I don't know what it's called.
But it's just like
currently Boston College is down 2-0 against Northeastern at the end of the second. So
Northeastern's pretty good.
Unless Boston University comes back and like gets their stuff together, they're probably going to be in the consolation round, which is going to be next Monday. I think all the both the final games are next Monday. So that these two games are today, the next two games are going to be next Monday. But you can stream them, it looks like, for free on the NCAA website. I just Googled Beanpot and it popped up. So if you want to watch Lane Hutson do his thing, when this airs, this game will be over, but next Monday on the 13th, whatever round he's in, you can watch him there. But yeah, he's been lighting it up as a rookie. I'm super proud of him.
Awesome.
Yeah. Good job. And he plays for, I might've said Boston College a couple times, but he plays for Boston University.
BU.
Be you.
Be yourself.
How very multicultural of them to call it a university as opposed to a collage.
I've never, like, here we don't call anything college except for, like, grammar school.
I think we're the only,
How about hockey school? Well, they just call it hockey school.
I think we're the only country that uses, like, college and university, like, interchangeably.
Yeah, that was always confusing to me in my... square brain.
Because we say I'm going to college, not I'm going to university.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And somebody said to me, an American friend of mine or American person that I know, was like amused by how I would say university instead of the university,
or yeah,
the hospital, or at hospital instead of mm-hmm. the hospital. And it sounded so weird to me.
It's just colloquialisms and language evolution.
There's something that drives me crazy, though, Beth, and you might have picked up on this as well as a lover of language. I watch a lot of these real estate shows and these home renovation shows and all that stuff. In the United States, every single person that I've seen on these programs calls realtors realtors.
Yeah.
Realtors, realtors. I'm always like, did I hear that?
Realtors. I don't know how that got to be a thing, but that is a thing here. Everybody calls them realtors.
Yes, I almost tweet it every time because it sounds so bad in my ear. And the other one is caregivers. Oh, that's what they are. They're caregivers. They're not caretakers. Caretaker is a different profession. Caregivers are the nurturers, providers of care in various different situations. Not caretakers.
Caregiver. Well, I think the thing with the caretakers, it's that they are taking care of blank, blank, blank.
Okay, I can see where that confusion would come in.
I'm going to give care to this. Nobody says that. I'm going to take care of this. Yes.
Again, it's
which,
yeah, okay, I can see that point.
Weird. Yeah.
Yeah, I see your point.
Yes.
But realtor, no. Stop with that shit. I'm going to write HGTV a stern.
Do it.
I always forget that real estate is actually like real estate. And not like some weird other spelling.
Word, like some weird term, yeah.
So I always go like to like Google like real estate. And I'm like, that's not how you spell it. Realtor, is it really real, realtor, estate? Real estate?
Okay, maybe that's where it comes
Same
from.
Same thing with lawyer. I don't like that word either. Because you're a lawyer.
Why the lawyer. Fuck is colonel spelled that way?
Well, that's, they even in French, they do it like that.
And we spell it lieutenant and call it lieutenant.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I don't understand that either.
I don't get it. Just spell it the way it sounds.
So speaking of lawyers.
Lawyer up.
I started watching She-Hulk, Attorney at Law. Finally. one of the shows from the MCU that I have failed to watch. Just because I forgot, I kind of forgot it. It existed till somebody mentioned it to me. I was like, oh shit, I gotta watch that at some point. So I started today. I think it's funny. I'm also very pleased that it makes one of the major plot points of the movie is that it references 2008's The Incredible Hulk, not 2003 The Hulk with Eric Bana, which didn't do all that well, but The Incredible Hulk 2008, which is literally the very first Marvel Cinematic Universe movie that starts everything that we deal with now. It started then. And Mark Ruffalo did not play the Hulk in that movie. It was played by none other than fucking Edward Norton.
It was.
Wow.
Yeah. Imagine the Avengers with Edward Norton. I think that'd be fucking cool. Yeah. Thing is, there was a big hoopla about that back in the day too. So what's funny about She-Hulk is that there's a nice tongue-in-cheek reference to that where Mark Ruffalo is talking to the She-Hulk and he's like, oh, that fight was so long ago. I was a completely different person referencing the first movie. And literally they broke the fourth wall when the She-Hulk like addresses the audience directly, says, ha ha, that's funny. And back
that's
to it.
Awesome.
I was like, ha, cute. That is funny. But I think it is cute. I think it is funny. Yeah. And people that say it's bad, I don't know, go jump in a fucking creek.
Yeah, maybe they hate fun.
Oh, the CGI looks so gamey. Man, you do it.
You know what?
You do it.
It's just like whenever I see a clever tweet or somebody saying something really cool or something funny or just whenever you see something that you particularly like, do not read the replies.
Yeah.
Don't read the replies.
People like to ruin fun. They don't like to let people enjoy things.
Like, really? And especially when they do it to social media teams. That one kills me.
Yeah. So that's what I started. Trying to think what else is going on.
I'll tell you what I've been watching.
I was going to mention one thing before we dive into that, because this will be a long... This is what we're watching. Half hour of the podcast. Leave Sean Monahan alone.
What the fuck, man?
Why are people going crazy? Like, we get so much information about medical updates now, and they're often wrong. Or at least, oh, that wasn't what they said the other day when so-and-so just decided to play a game again.
Whatever. Yeah.
I forget the example, but that seemed to be a common occurrence.
It's not Sean Monahan's fucking fault.
Like, Mike Matheson. Right? Yeah, Matheson, for instance. Yeah. Oh, yeah, he's out for 2 weeks, plays the next game. What? That's weird. Kind of strange. They haven't given an update on Monahan in a while. Who the fuck cares? Because if they mention it, it's probably going to be wrong, and then it's going to be more shit for people to stir about stuff that they don't need to know about in the first place. It drives me nuts. I don't care!
They made it worse because they said that we would get an update by the end of the week on Friday. So like by, before this past Friday.
And I missed that.
Yeah. They said that earlier. I think it was like last Tuesday. They said, we'll give an update on Monahan by the end of the week. And now it is Monday and it's, we haven't heard anything.
That,
so people are freaking out about that.
That gives how they said that Miss France Bélanger, their vice president. Yeah, Francis.
Yeah.
Mentioned, oh, put in some questions and she'll answer it for you. Never happened because that was only a little time after Logan Mayu was drafted in the first round.
Oh my God, why was everybody talking about that kid again this weekend?
Because he had a good game. He
scored a Michigan goal.
He scored a Michigan. That's right. He had a good game.
Well, I didn't see anything about him scoring a goal. I saw
and then there was
people wanting to flagellate the kid again.
About him facing adversity. And the adversity in the article mentioned was a teammate dying and him stepping up and being a leader. But a lot of people didn't read the article before they started yelling about it.
Yeah.
And so that's caused some tiffs on the Twitter.
Yeah.
Jordan Harris came out, said something good.
Yeah.
Glad he's on the team.
Did he come out?
No. He
Came out with a good statement. How did I miss that?
Okay. He spoke instead of with his words instead of coming out of a certain domicile within a house. No, he spoke out against the Rangers and Provorov in general about being anti-LGBT, you know, QA plus. He was like, well, you know, if hockey's for everyone, how come they're doing this? It totally says that hockey is not for everyone. He said that almost verbatim, like a very on the nose, like stop fucking around with that though.
And like, I already love Jordan Harris so much. And every day he just makes me love him even more.
Yeah. Now I am glad that Jordan Harris is a Hab. That's some good shit right there.
Yeah. Good. I'm proud of him.
Yeah. That's pretty much all the Habs news I have, like officially. I was going to mention that and done.
Yeah. There is one thing that I wanted to mention about that whole thing. And it's just like, you know, I talk to kids, my kids' ages. None of these kids are assholes. None of them are assholes.
Sure
none of them. None of them that I know.
Okay.
Like, nobody gives a fucking shit about the rainbow flag. Nobody gives a shit about BLM shit in schools or whatever. Like, they're all like, okay, like, why don't we just make everybody feel as good as we can? Of course I know, of course there are a lot of teenagers that are assholes and school-aged kids that are assholes, but you know, I'm talking more like young 20s, like
my kids, the general populace are more about like, yeah, we shouldn't be dickholes, which is nice because the next generation should fix the world as we've been telling ourselves for the past 60 years.
Well, I have faith in Gen Z. It's so funny because my son, who is Gen Z, is always saying to me that Gen X was the last good generation, which, you know, I agree.
I'd listen to him.
As a generation.
I'd listen to him.
And because like he gets driven crazy by Gen Zers. But you know what? Gen Zers, I think that they're going to do shit. They're going to do shit.
The Washington Post poll felt
bad for itself.
I was reading
these guys are going to actually do things.
I was reading a poll about that. You know, Americans that are that are vote eligible. Don't know if how many people actually answer these things, but they're saying that. What was it there? Of course, I don't have the figures right in front of me. They said something like 56% of people think Biden is doing a poor job, and 48% do not desire a rematch between Biden and Trump. It's like, wow.
Okay.
So more than half of the country thinks Biden's doing bad, and almost half do not want a matchup like that. And like, well, I'm sure that's very that certainly tells me a lot. Washington Post, ABC, really appreciate it.
Yeah.
Try to see if I can find it.
I mean, the propaganda there is like you know, like Tucker Carlson, his whole thing with the M&Ms. I think it just has to do with, you know, he wants his M&Ms to look sexy so that he's not accidentally slapping it to a male M&M. Like, what? Like, why?
I think it's the opposite. He doesn't.
You think it's the opposite?
He does
he's
not
homophobic.
Well,
M&Ms to be sexy.
There could be the underlying want to screw M&Ms. I don't blame him. Thing is, his whole thing is that why do it all started with the green M&M, the one lady M&M at the time. Yeah. And she wore kinky boots, heeled boots, white, like go-go boots and whatnot. Yeah, go-go right?
girl.
And that's what started it all. Like, even before it was like a Tucker Carlson thing, they, like, I remember the...
That's not, stupid.
That just people were saying, like, why does she have heels on? It's like, I don't know.
It's for fun. It's a fucking piece of candy. That
it's a cartoon chocolate candy.
Like, Daisy Duck had heels.
Yeah.
Nobody cared about that. I mean, they kind of looked like clogs because look how wide their feet are, but
they were enormous oval like pumps. But
Donald Duck didn't even wear pants.
Yeah. So, neither do the M&M, so it doesn't help.
Cross-dresser.
So.
Well, I'm very much looking forward to Maya Rudolph making an absolute mockery of Tucker Carlson with this, the Super Bowl commercials because she's involved with that M&M campaign.
Yes. Mm-hmm. I feel like they're going to bring out Maya Rudolph and the M&Ms. Like, I feel like this is like a big lead up to the Super Bowl commercials.
Well, any advertising team that doesn't take advantage of all of the publicity that these morons are giving them that not worth their salt.
For sure.
Okay. I wanted to make a mention of something before we dive into what we're watching. Our friend, our dear friend, Simon Salikas.
Yeah.
Simon.
And his friends, Joey Alfieri and Dave Trentadue, have a new show on TSN 690. Ooh. It's every weekend, Saturday and Sunday, starting at 7 a.m. Eastern, which is 4 a.m. Pacific. So they better be podcasting that shit. But I'm really looking forward to it because those three guys are just wonderful. Joey Alfieri is funny as hell. Dave Trentadue is such a sweetheart. And Simon is quintessentially Simon.
So, I would never do that job.
Well,
not in a million years. What's the time slot?
I have to this trio.
7 in the morning? Every weekend?
Saturday indeterminate... and Sunday, yo.
Yeah. No, I would not do that.
At like 8 p.m., 9 p.m.
Dude, they better be getting paid for that. Jesus. My God.
Well, I'm looking forward to that opportunity because they're all three so wonderful that I think it's going to be a great combination. Simon does like to talk about football and soccer a lot.
Well, he's a Renaissance man. He's an expert in all fields.
Yeah. So I wanted to give them a little shout out because I'm apparently it started last weekend, but I just found out about it. So
yeah,
good for them.
The starters.
Good.
The liberal starters. 7 a.m.
It's called the starters.
It's called the starters. Like maybe starting lineup.
No, I get it. It's clever.
Okay.
First thing in the morning. Clever.
I'm happy for them.
They could have called it the early birds.
Yeah.
Well, that's cool.
They could have. Yeah.
All right. Don't have any more Habs stuff to talk about.
Okay,
so,
Glaucus.
Yeah. Actually, we should do that before we get into what we're watching, even though I already talked about She-Hulk, Attorney at Law. Which, like I said, it had a good loop into the very, very first movie when they brought back Abomination, whom was Emil Plansky, the first villain in the MCU. Anyway, Glaucus, 123, my new, what's the word, the moniker,
Twitter handle.
On Twitter. It is an old gamer tag.
Okay.
When I say gamer tag, it was my first, actually. That gets, okay. Anyways, I use it predominantly, though, on Steam. If anybody plays games with me on Steam, which has not happened in many years... Glaucus is one of my usernames on Steam. Now, it's also my PlayStation Network name as well. And why Glaucus? Glaucus is from Greek mythology.
I knew. Why did I? What? I don't know. Maybe I've had this conversation already.
It's a possible. Glaucus, back in the Greek mythology days, he was a fisherman, caught some fish. Storm happens. Poseidon, blah, blah, blah. Hates people in general. Now he's shipwrecks on an island. Glaucus has to eat these fish that he caught to survive. Apparently, these fish were divine, though. And in so doing so, becomes like a, not like a god god, but like a whatever Hercules is, like a meta god, a demigod, right? And he then becomes a servant of Poseidon, guiding fishermen across the seas and blah, 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 blah. Glaucus is also a very pretty fish. But when I was putting it together, I always liked the idea of, oh, you don't really hear about, you know, a normal person becoming like a god in Greek mythology. I thought that was very unique for the pantheon.
Oh, and my goodness, like, that's a beautiful fish.
Oh, I know, right? So that's why I was like, okay, I'll make that my gamer tag. And it's been the case ever since. So I figured, oh, I haven't used that on Twitter in a long time. My very, very, very first Twitter handle was Glaucus01 until I moved it to MetalDave01 until it was demolished by Lindsey Graham, who I hope goes to jail for being a seditionist piece of shit. And I'll never get my account back because I called him out on being a shitbag.
That's so incredible to me what these horrible people get away with. Did you see there was Jesse Spector? He's more of like a baseball dude. He's okay. In Brooklyn, and he's on Twitter, and a lovely guy. He had me on his podcast one time. Oh, just nice. A lovely, lovely guy. Legacy blue check mark.
All right. So he may or may not be
in the neighborhood. Who is the biggest bitch in the neighborhood? This Elon Musk. My goodness gracious.
So with a legacy blue check mark, that means that this person may or may not be notable.
Okay. Well, and the people who are paying for their fucking check marks, what are they?
Idiots.
Like 400 followers blue check mark because I'm paying Elon Musk $8. That's what he's mad about. These people aren't paying him $8. So he's got to be a petty little bitch.
Oh, yes.
And I hate that word.
Oh, yeah. Did you watch that video I sent you guys about the person explaining the whole...
Not yet.
It is. Do it.
Can you please resend it? Because I can't scroll back. Married. Our group chat can be voluminous.
Hey, Elon, why don't you add pinned messages to group chats? Or actually make the...
Scroll through media in DMs.
Or actually make the pinned DMs pin. Because they don't. It only pins like one of them. And it's such a pain in the ass.
Yeah. Guess which one I have pinned?
Us.
Yeller.
That's pretty cool. Yeah. Oh, okay. I'm going to look for that.
Because I'm there more than anything anymore. Yeah. Hardly ever looking at real Twitter.
It's going to take me a while to find that.
Okay. Okay. So what have we been watching? Have you been watching anything, Beth?
Not anything like traditional. I've been watching this guy on YouTube. His name is Chris Ramsey, and he solves like puzzles, but not like he doesn't do like jigsaw puzzles and stuff. It's like stuff you have to like take the puzzle apart. Like it'd be like an object, and it's like, oh, this is a die, and it's like a big wooden die, but you have to like do certain things to it to unlock it and open it up, and there's like a prize inside.
Oh, cool.
And he collects unusual decks of playing cards. So if people send him puzzles that they make, a lot of times they'll put in like the prize will be an unusual deck of playing cards for him. So I watch him. His channel is Chris Ramsey 52 on YouTube. I don't know. It's cool. Relaxing and it's interesting.
Yeah.
I'm like, I would get frustrated and throw this at the wall. And he like has a timer up and like sometimes he'll time lapse and whatever, but it'll take him like hours to solve some of these puzzles. And I'm like, I couldn't do it. I would be mad. But some of them are really cool. Like there's one and it's like a wooden box that has crayons in it, like 5 crayons in it. And you have to like unlock the crayons and open the box.
I'm totally watching.
Like some of them are big, like huge, and some of them are smaller. But yeah, he's got like loads of videos and he seems like a cool dude. And he also does like sleight of hand magic as well. So he's like, I'm going to do a trick because he's, I guess, like a part-time magician too. But he's a cool dude. I like him.
And that's
like
good.
A soothing voice. It's pretty relaxing, even though like he's stressed out. Like it's pretty relaxing to watch.
Good old fashioned, wholesome content.
Yes.
I'm here for it. And speaking of the opposite of wholesome content, I have been watching. So I know that Dave is going to know exactly who this actor who I'm talking about is. Dominic West?
Nope.
So I'd never heard of this guy before in my fucking life. And he played Charles in the last season of The Crown. which was very disconcerting because he looked nothing like Charles and had has these huge brown, chocolate brown eyes.
Oh, this guy.
Yeah. And he, I guess he was in The Wire for a long time. But so I just saw him now in The Crown, you know, when that came out. But I've been watching now this show that's long done. So I'm reaching now the end, the final conclusion of this series. But it's called The Affair.
Mm-hmm.
And it is like it goes for five seasons and it tracks this guy, Dominic West. His character is an author or a struggling aspiring writer. Trying to put his first novel together. He's got his wife. He's got these four children. They live in Brooklyn, which is why I was thinking of Brooklyn. So beautiful. Brooklyn. Anyway, the affair. So no spoiler here. He has an affair with this woman that he meets when they go to vacation in Montauk. Mm-hmm. And anyway, this story goes on. It interweaves all of these different characters and different families. And the story, the main story that's told in every episode is two parts, his story and her story, or, you know, the two characters that are in that episode. It's each episode is told from their point of view. And so anyway, there's just such, it's quite painful to watch actually, because there's such intergenerational trauma with these people, and it's just, you know, but I have to go to the end and see how it ends, because it's the writing is very good, but the performances are excellent. And I kind of have a crush on Joshua Jackson. He was in that show, Dawson's Creek.
Oh my god.
Yeah.
Oh, that guy.
He looks like a little chipmunk now because he's got this beard that covers his face like this. And he's just such a lovely, wonderful actor, a lovely, wonderful performer. So, and I just kind of like him. So I'm going to look up more stuff that he's in.
Good.
The Affair. So it's on HBO. Oh, no, Showtime. And I get it in Canada, again, through Crave. Yeah. And I've been binging it for days since there's no hockey. And I technically had Friday off.
So, interesting thing about Josh Jackson, that's probably going to horrify you.
Oh, no.
He was in the Mighty Ducks.
I'll watch that finally over Christmas.
He was in all three of them as Charlie Conway, number 96.
He's just a cutie patootie.
Mm-hmm.
He's just so cute.
That's funny.
And now he's all grown up.
He was also
the other thing is these people all have sex with each. Like, okay, you don't have to have sex with everybody. And you also don't have to show us every time somebody does it. Like, that's a big part of the show if everybody likes sexy time. And I don't kind of get why we need it so much. Like, I guess
sex
it
makes sells. Us
the characters better.
Tale as old as time.
Tale as old as time.
He was also in Muppets in Space, or Muppets from Space, I should say.
Yeah, that's post Jim Henson.
Yep. Yeah, that's too bad. He was in Ocean's 11 as himself.
Oh, really?
Yep. Cameo. And look at that.
Yeah, he's just a wonderful artist. I really enjoyed him in this show. Oh,
He did voices in Gravity Falls. How nice.
Oh, good for
well,
him.
Well.
And The Simpsons.
The female, you know, kind of like one of the women that the story centers around is this British actress. And also this Dominic West guy, he's British too. And they're all doing very convincing American accents.
They're British. It's just what they do.
They're much better at it. Like, yes. When North Americans try to do the British accent, it's a little embarrassing. Like, what the fuck are you?
So, more about Dominic West. Dominic West also had a part in Spice World and Star Wars Episode I, The Phantom Menace. I was shocked to read that. He played one of the temple guards for Princess Amidala.
Leia.
No. This is talking about the before she was born, guys.
My boyfriend instantly knew who he was because he was famous from The Wire, which I've also seen because
Oh, he was also in 300. Oh, he was the bad guy in 300. One of the bad politicians in Sparta. I remember him now.
Yeah, he goes psycho sometimes, and he's like scary psycho.
Oh yeah,
scary.
He was he was not a great dude in 300.
Oh no.
Oh, he also played the main bad guy in The Punisher. Ooh, yeah, that guy Jigsaw. Yeah.
At first, I hated him, and now he's kind of got me pulling for him. I kind of hope he has a good ending.
He was a voice in Finding Dory.
Oh.
And played Lara Croft's father, Lord Richard Croft, in Tomb Raider 2018.
Oh, wow. Quite the resume, this guy.
Oh, yeah. He'll be in the new Downton Abbey that's coming out. He was in 28 Days Later. He was in Chicago. The musical.
The musical?
As Fred Casely.
I don't know.
Don't recall
anyway,
that.
His physicality is also like props.
He was also in John Carter. Terrible movie.
Which one was that?
That was a
I think I saw it.
I can't even explain what the hell it is.
Is that Denzel?
They tried. No.
No.
No. This was like starring Taylor Kitsch, Lynn Collins.
Oh my god, the guy from Friday Night Lights.
Oh yeah, Mark Strong was in it too. Oh, and Willem Dafoe. Despite this terrible movie. James Purefoy as well. It was John Carter's based on like a comic book from the 1940s, 1950s. Like one of the first ideas of like what a super person would be. Except this super person ends up on Mars and does shit. And hence John Carter. It's a Disney flick and it was awful. It happens to the best of us.
Yeah.
That's cool. So, what was it called? Affair.
The Affair.
Gotcha.
The Affair. Showtime.
Showtime. Ah, it's a Showtime show.
It ran for 5 years, actually. Yeah, isn't that Showtime gave us the L word, didn't they?
Mm-hmm.
I love the sexy time.
Oh, yeah. Also, thank you for all of our watchers on YouTube. Our first video to go over 1,000 views was the L word.
Oh, that's right. We called it the L word. All of a sudden, everybody was clicking.
Yeah, that was pretty funny. Oops. Not at all about that.
I don't care. No apologies. What shall we call it this time? Sexy time in every episode.
I mean, one of my Metal Dave videos, I called it Sex Ba-Bomb, which was a reference to Scott Pilgrim. And that also got very popular just because sex is in the title. Thanks, right. Algorithm.
Sexy time in every episode.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
I like that.
We already have a low element. Let's not go even lower into the gutter. All right, Beth, what have you been watching?
It's Dominic West.
Yeah. Dominic West. Just a lovely, lovely human being.
Dominic
West. And Maura Tierney, whose performance in this is heartbreakingly good.
Excellent.
She's so good. I think she won a few awards. Good. I think the show did itself as well. Because nice. I didn't like just the premise. I'm already like, oh, motherfuckers who cheat. And do I really want to watch this? And I'd kind of scrolled past it a few times. And I'm very glad because that they're like the performances are really, really good.
Excellent.
Yeah.
I am trying to look up something here. So aside from She-Hulk, Attorney at Law. Which I'm kind of looking forward to watching a lot of it more tonight, too. Once I figure out what the hell's wrong with this freaking hard drive that I did buy. That's not getting picked up for some reason. I spent an hour leading up to recording today. My computer was in pieces. Actually, the power supply is still outside of the actual computer box right now, but it's fine. It's still plugged in. It's fine. Don't worry about it. And, look at that. We're running out of time-ish. That's weird. Another show I'm started watching that Veronica did not start watching is Shrinking.
It's because I'm stuck watching The Affair.
I haven't started watching it either.
And Inner She, Binner She, or something like Inner She, Inner Shin, something that everybody's talking about. Some show that's out now with a very odd title. Banshees of Inner Shin or something?
Isn't that a movie? Something like
is it? Netflix? I thought it was something that that was an option, but I keep forgetting what it's called.
That is a movie that I do want to watch. It is a dramedy starring very Irish people.
Yeah.
That include, where the hell are they? So two of the most Irish people you can think of being Colin Farrell and Brendan Gleeson.
Oh.
And it's supposed to be very, very good. But yes, that is a movie, a 2.5 hour movie.
Yeah, I saw them touting that one on Colbert.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, I know what movie it is now.
Yeah, that came out.
Yeah, they make a very funny couple.
Yes, that came out back in October. It's been on my.
But it's out on Netflix now, isn't it? Everybody's talking about it. Or maybe it's on demand.
It's on something, because I've seen it pop up as well, and I want to catch it. So I keep thinking. Shrinking is one of those one of those series on Apple TV Plus, starring none other than Jason Segel and Harrison Ford, of all people. as we've mentioned last week, Harrison Ford does not do TV. As Brett Bernstein in an interview with Stephen Colbert previously also mentioned this. It's a cool show. It's getting better as the episodes go on too, which I'm happy about. Because the first episode I was like, I get it, but best dialogue Harrison Ford's ever seen? I don't think so. That guy was in The Fugitive, for God's sake.
Damn it. One of my favorites. Witness.
Witness. Also Witness very so good. So yes. good. Oh my Lord, so good.
So good.
But yeah, the whole premise of Shrinking is that Harrison Ford is Jason Segel's, I guess, boss and they're both therapists, you know, and Harrison Ford runs his own, you know, therapy thing. And then Segel's like one of the under therapists that work under Ford, and Jason Segel is navigating some extreme trauma in his life, and he's trying to cope with that, I believe, in attempting like experimental treatment with patients that Harrison Ford does not like, and all the crazy things start to happen. But it's pretty funny. It's a good guffaw every once in a while.
He'll be next on my list then. I always say that to you, so.
In particular, there is, I don't know the guy's name. Where is he? Donnie? Is this guy named Donnie? No, I don't know. I'm not going to be able to find the guy because he's
from
like.
From that show?
From that show. He's, Jason Segel has a neighbor who's been helping him take care of things. And this neighbor has a husband who I think is hilarious. I absolutely love him whenever he's on the screen because he always does whatever his wife tells him to do in the most upbeat fashion. But you know, he in no way wants to do this thing. He just goes on with it like, okay, honey, no problem. I love it. That's not a great explanation of what he is, but he just has a demeanor about him where I'm like, yes, perfect. Perfect. Oh, hi, Pam. You don't say hi to Pam. Oh, get fucked, Pam. Then drives off. Just whatever his wife says. It's no problem. But yeah, it is a cool show, and I'm looking forward to see how it goes on. And yeah, there it is. All right, we're in the last 2 minutes of the Habby Hour this week.
Allegedly, season 3 of Ted Lasso comes out this spring. Maybe we will get an announcement during the Superb Owl.
Which is this weekend, so everyone put in your Superb Owl bets.
Yes.
See who will win the
Rihanna's doing the halftime show. I can't wait to watch that.
Oh. Yes, that's worth it. Oh, yeah, the Grammys.
Oh my God!
I didn't watch either.
I didn't watch, but I was seeing the nominations and the winners. I'm like, man, the thing that got me is Beyonce winning both the dance album and electronic album of the year awards. I'm like, she's not an electronic artist.
Yeah.
And there was a DJ talking about it, and he was like, you know, there's a lot of DJs out there, and for Beyonce to win it. doesn't sit right with me, which is strange. Yeah. Which is
Mika
the case
because Zibanejad was snubbed.
Oh yeah, who is that?
It's a Mika Zibanejad.
Oh yeah, see that
he
too.
Hasn't put out a new album in a while, but
and poor Harry Styles stepping right into it. This doesn't happen to people like me often, Harry. Buddy,
Harry.
It does every day.
But no, what amused me was watching clips of Whitest Boy Alive, Ben Affleck, at the Grammys while Jay was dancing time. Beside him to like groove into the music. He just looks miserable and like they're like.
I wish he was right smoking
trending.
In that moment. Just doesn't care. Gets out a pack of Camels, whatever they smoke in Boston. Just. Absolutely done with it.
Okay. Yeah, it's very, very funny, and he's probably going to be roasted on the late night talk shows.
Oh yeah.
Oh, good for him.
Oh, good.
Yeah. So that was the only thing, and then the other thing, of course, is inevitably Madonna gets an award for being one of the most successful artists of all time, and all anybody can do is bitch about what her face looks like.
Oh, I finally found. Yes, true. I finally found this guy's name. The husband that I really like in Shrinking, his name is Ted McGinley, I guess. And he was Jefferson Darcy on Married with Children.
Sorry.
Very funny.
I'm
going
to take you way back.
He was also on The Love Boat.
He was on Happy Days. He played Roger.
Oh my God, he did.
Kind of major crush on him. Happy Days was on after school every day.
Oh yeah, because it was one of the best shows ever created.
Yeah. Oh no, like, you watch that show, please, for Henry Winkler alone.
Oh my God,
he's just so wonderful.
Like on top of watching Barry, I kind of had to do a little bit of a Henry Winkler deep dive. Recon?
Yeah.
Another great movie with Henry Winkler is goddamn The Waterboy, because he was the coach in that. Remember?
No, I have not seen Waterboy.
Oh?
Adam Sandler.
I'm not an Adam Sandler person.
I'm not. I love him. He seems like a lovely guy.
Oh,
but
my God. That movie is like Forrest Gump with football. It is so goddamn funny. Oh my God.
Yeah, I'll check it out. I'll take your word for it. Another Henry Mama Winkler says, gem? What's that?
Well, Mama says I can do whatever. Oh my God. It's just, oh my God. Oh, it's so good. Like, I want to watch it now, Waterboy. I remember.
No, I kind of want to too.
Because, like I said, him as Henry Winkler as like the coach of like the Gators down in Florida. He's like, go on, guys, just have yourselves a good time. Play some ball, run in the right direction. It's just, it's almost like his character from Barry, except doing football, but not nearly as aggressive. It's so, so funny. Oh my God.
It is very funny. Very quickly, because I know we don't have a lot.
Oh yeah, we're out.
Check out Night Shift. Night Shift with Henry Winkler, my boyfriend, Michael Keaton, and Shelley Long of Cheers.
Ooh.
It that movie has so many good lines in it, like classics. That Barney Rubble, what an actor.
Yes.
From that one.
Something else.
They work in a morgue and they turn it into a, like, what are they called? A sex worker establishment.
A cat house.
Yeah, well, I was trying to think of a word that wasn't
brothel.
Yeah, a brothel.
Okay. Yeah, it's a brothel.
They turn the morgue into.
You can find a place to sleep. You can find a meal. You can find a lady. Welcome to the brothel. All right. Something else with Mr. Ted McGinley. He was also Mr. Scream in Wayne's World 2 when they're on the radio.
Yes.
Another movie I have to rewatch now because I love Wayne's World. Wayne's going through the concert and the one lady comes over. He's like, never learned how to read. Okay, we gotta go. We gotta go. Bye, everyone. Thank you for listening. Subscribe, etc. Habs play on Saturday against the Islanders, and they got to go up against Bo Horvat in his 8x8 freaking contract. Good. And the Bravery.